各位贵宾，我们的演讲即将开始。麻烦各位贵宾，请把手机关静音，谢谢。
各位贵宾，大家午安，下午好。今天因为能源大楼起源厅哦，对那个外访的贵宾来讲，好像有点难找到哦，可能还有蛮多人还在找路当中哦。那但是今天精彩的演讲，我想我们可能就必须要开始了哦。那这次的活动非常开心哦，因为早上呢，我们还刚举行完了那个盘运云华的开幕典礼。那最主要的缘由，我想今天请到新加坡知名的团队沃哈来做这样子的一个演讲的原因是，3年前，我们当时在水南经贸园区替台中市市政府承揽的水南愿景馆里面，当时在铺陈着透过水南经贸园区的这样子一个大型的规划，怎么样让台中市可以展现更美丽的城市。所以在一系列的城市的历史结构的背景底下，我记得当时卓胜荣卓董，今天到了吗？也在赶路中哦，卓董当时帮了很大的忙，诉说着台中市建筑的故事。那当然整个 master plan， 我想当时的纪联组杨富参与，还有记得张景尧张建筑师应该今天有在场哈。那当时整个的 master plan 是由普林斯顿的院长 Stan Allen 来负责。那在一路的建筑走下来的过程中呢，到了第三站我们要展览的时候，我们觉得应该开始谈所谓的美好的绿色的永续的建筑。那个时候呢，我们就非常很仔细的在寻找着什么样的建筑最适合来台湾做这样的呈现。那在那一年3年前，沃哈当时正好沃哈的事务所团队刚好在做世界的巡回展览。那他们当时的主题就是会呼吸的建筑。那3年前其实已经在水南愿景馆给了一场非常精彩的演讲，可是因为3年前的结缘，好，我们很希望推动台中市美丽的建筑，可是美丽的建筑总是需要期待哦。那终于在1年前，盘玉建设张大方张董事长带着他的团队到办公室来找我。我今天早上致辞讲一样的话，盖房子呢，在座所有的建筑专家、建筑师、建筑业界朋友们，比我们都会盖。那在1年前呢，盘玉的团队来到凤凰大学我的小小办公室的时候，我觉得蓬荜生辉，非常光荣。那当时来找我就是希望说能够引荐新加坡的这个团队，然后来到我们台中市打造美丽的城市。所以这样一段美丽的姻缘，然后美丽的这样的一个这栋建筑就即将在我们台中市呈现。我想在我们当时3年前的初衷以及在1年前盘玉来找我们，以及在1年后今天早上的开幕，以及今天下午的演讲，其实是三方的一个合作机会。那三方呢，就是透过当时学术界希望打造美好的台中市，我们当时非常的尽心尽力，这个梦想终于在这样的一个机会当中促成。第二件呢，这个美丽的设计如果没有一个很勇敢的业主，其实也很难让它实现。那当时呢，我们也非常的幸运，在过去的一年里面，盘玉建设终于成为这个非常勇敢的业主，好，愿意有一个这样的案子在台中市产生。那当然背后最重要能够把台中市打造成为一个国际级竞争的美丽的绿色城市，我们很希望带进这样子的一个绿色建筑的典范。所以呢黄文森建筑师沃哈这样一个团队就在我们这样的一个机会机缘下打造出来。那当然这个案子其实我还要非常感谢我们的 local 建筑师，我们台湾配合建筑师亚门刘伟燕刘建筑师，以及许龙江许建筑师出现了，伟燕出现了。好，那其实大家都知道国际团队非常合作非常的困难，好，但是我们这个案子呢，在彼此学习之中，包括那个亚门有非常多本土的 know how，也都毫无藏私的，那跟这个新加坡团队非常强的很多的 know how 彼此交流当中，我想是一个非常激荡的火花。那么透过这一次的这样子的一个机会，也透过今天的演讲，我希望接下来的演讲呢，黄文森黄建筑师沃哈的团队可以给我们展现他们最精彩的建筑。然后坦白说，待会是全英文演讲，因为黄建筑师坚持不希望，他偷笑了，我一直跟他沟通能不能同步，他就觉得他不想要被打断。然后我今天早上试着想要问问看说，那我是不是应该在开场的时候介绍一些他们得奖的作品。我知道他们得到了51项国际大奖，所以我在问说我是不是应该特别介绍哪几栋。各位，接下来的案子我今天早上才知道，每一栋建筑100%全部都是国际得奖的作品。所以各位今天应该是非常非常的幸运哦，就像我应该是第一次 或第二次看到其中哈，三年前可能很多的作品，但是可能在这三年当中又有非常多新的概念产生。所以呢，我请代表辅导大学有这样的一个机会一起来欢迎黄文森黄建筑师的一个作品。那也谢谢各位在今天百忙中能够抽空前来，谢谢。I'm going to. We 杨副校长不要代表校方致辞一下，支持一下好了，真的。Have a seat. Have a seat. Have a seat. Have a seat.
我们李主任哈，还有黄建筑师张董。各位先进大家午安。其实整个背景刚刚李主任都有说得很清楚，从2012年我们水南的 InfoBox 那时候来展览那也引起了大家的一个对这样的一个建筑相当的有兴趣。那也很感谢我们盘毅建设能够首先的能够带进来。那我相信这个案子应该会给我们台中带来更多的一个反响那包括现在据我了解，我们种什么的直升都还在测试当中能够实际的符合我们台湾这种亚热带气候的这样的一种建筑这完全的立体化的一个立建筑我想今天的谢谢黄建筑师能够来这个地方演讲能够让大家很丰收而归。再次跟各位抱歉，因为这个可能标示不够清楚，很难找整个的一个演讲能够很圆满的成功，谢谢。
我们这次的所有的活动的赞助是由盘毅建设来赞助这样的一个活动。那么张大方张董事长，是，请简短致个词。简短，你可以很简短，一分钟就好。
杨副校长以及各位贵宾、各位同学，大家午安，大家好。很高兴那有这个机会跟逢甲大学建筑系合作。那也很荣幸的有机会跟沃哈那实际上来合作这个案子。那坦白说经过了一年多的时间的磨合，每个礼拜的视讯，到去年的12月我们终于拿到建造。到现在我想这个是一个新的开始。那我想我们盘毅建设会继续坚持走这条绿色的建筑做下去，谢谢各位。
Okay, 2 minutes. 沃哈团队在1994年成立，由今天的主持建筑师黄文森黄建筑师以及来自于澳洲的 Richard Hussle 在1994年成立。那我刚提到得到了目前到目前为止赢得了51项国际大奖。在2000年开始参加新加坡的捷运设计的时候，开始沃哈就从小的尺度进到了公共的尺度。其中呢有非常多得奖的作品，包括我们其实在台湾看到的很多的集合住宅，以及公共的建筑，然后休闲的建筑，然后包括很精彩的这个教堂的设计。那在这个当中呢有非常非常多的国际奖项，我刚刚也讲了，不是只有一栋建筑、两栋、七栋，而是每一栋都是。好，那我想今天的主题呢跟三年前的 Breathing Architecture 会呼吸的建筑完全不一样。三年后今天黄文森黄建筑师要跟我们分享的是今天的演讲主题 Macro Architecture 跟 Micro Urbanism， 放大的建筑跟跟缩小的都市，好，微型的城市。那我们现在就是以这个热烈掌声欢迎黄文森黄建筑师。
Thank you, Suthin.This lecture is based on the topics and agenda for our next book, hopefully will come out this year. And it's a focus in the direction of our design studio for the next, as we move into the next, the third decade of our practice. So in the last 20 years, we accomplished quite a lot, we feel. But in the next decade, we certainly have got a new direction and a new focus, and it's something that we would like to discuss in this lecture and also in the book to come sometime this year. I think this is a information newspaper, and it's a think tank who actually looked at the rate of growth of rise of mega cities, and you can see right now it is 1965. That was roughly the time I was born. There were only two major mega cities. That's New York and Tokyo. We have a population of over 10 million people. But as the following decades unfold, and certainly in around 1995, you can see the intensification of urbanization in India and in China. And you can see how it intensifies at an alarming rate. And today, we have something like 23 mega cities in the world. And in the year 2025, we will have 37. And this rate of urbanization cannot keep growing in this manner. I think the effects of this, what we call the urban puberty, is that we have cities in China that is actually created within 25 years. And I think over the last 100 years or so, the way we plan cities hasn't really changed at all. It is still very much based on the way we design around automobiles. And it certainly has its problems and issues. We have worked in quite a lot of these mega cities, like in Bangkok. When we first practiced in Bangkok some more than 10 years ago, Bangkok, you could barely walk on the streets, really. And it was full of traffic jams. And I think up to today, you still have a lot of building models that are actually not appropriate and suitable for Bangkok, the tropical weather. And our project address those issues. This is Guangzhou. We also have another project here. And you can see it is fairly homogeneous in the way buildings are made. It is quite faceless, and it's really quite, you can't really tell that it's actually Guangzhou, really. And this is actually the problem we have in the world today in all the cities. In Jakarta, the rise of the middle income class is quicker than the pace of infrastructure being built. And every time I go into Jakarta, I sit in traffic jams for about 3 to 4 hours before I attend the meeting. It is actually a very sad situation. And Mumbai is no worse. And I think Mumbai, the population, it's quite alarming, the rate of urbanization, and they can't build fast enough to satisfy their demand. And in Dhaka, we're building a university. But what is really sad is that 40% of the people live in slums. But I think there is future in it. And I think for all the cities, they can actually leapfrog into the future if they can get their act together and get things done before it gets too late. So really, our work has been in the last 10 years or so been rethinking how we plan cities, how we think urbanism, and how we actually consider new typologies, building typologies that's actually suitable for the climate and the context. Finding strategies and solutions and rating systems that addresses the issues of the 21st century. Both end, architecture and urbanism. I think we cannot think of architecture alone or urbanism alone. And I think we cannot always think of one thing at a time, but we actually have to think of many things at a time, many users and multiple strategies and multiple purposes all together in one time. So in a project that we took part with the University and the Design Singapore, they set us a problem. Imagine Singapore in 2050. And I think one of the things that we realize about the world today is that there is overcrowding, there's global warming, but there is actually water rising as well. So Singapore is one of those few places we feel is being threatened by rising water. And by 2050, it's possible that if you take the worst case scenario, the water would have risen something like 10 to 14 meters, and we will lose something like 1/4 to 1/3 of the land in Singapore. So we talk about it, and we realize that we need to not think about, we need to think about how we address these problems holistically. And as you can see in this slide, it was a little bit futuristic, but we envisage rebuilding our coastal area so that it is actually a land, it's actually a raised ring that is actually being created and built with more land sales and building more buildings to actually finance and support this infrastructure so that we are actually in the end protected by the rising water. And at the same time, we can actually use tides to actually create and create alternative energy. And in this case, this twin towers is actually where it funnels the tide between the sea and inland so that you can actually run turbines to generate alternative energy. I mean, this is a visionary project. It's not real in any sense, but it's how we feel that we actually need to solve many issues and many problems at the same time. And this image was one that in Singapore, we have shortage of land. And I think in cities, you do all have shortage of land because you want to be compact and small. And in Singapore, the best form of alternative energy is actually solar. But we don't have enough land, but we certainly have enough buildings and roofs. And if you can decide that all the roofs are collectively used to focus energy, solar energy, we could actually become a zero energy country as well. So this is an image of all this new landscape, but all this new landscape are actually buildings. We have condominiums, we have mixed use, we have everything. But it's actually using buildings to create a new surrounding landscape waterfront for Singapore. And in this image you see is one of very green fields, but it's actually many layers, the top layer being a green field and also actually in this case is actually landed housing. But below it is many layers of factories. You don't see the factories because factories need very large floor plates. And you can actually try to mechanically ventilate those factories. But yet, on the roof level, you could afford to create an entirely new ground level that can be used for other purpose. So there was also another opportunity for us to stretch our thinking a little bit. And I think it was one of the Vertical Cities Asia symposium and competition that was held in Singapore in 2011. And the topic was chosen as a place to imagine what 100,000 people in 1 square kilometer would be. And that would actually mean having another 5 million Singaporeans living in 45 square kilometers. And we were thinking how, if it's actually possible at high density, whether it would be livable, but yet having all the high amenities associated with having land on ground. So this image was one that we created using, again, buildings for many purposes. And in these buildings, the buildings were supporting infrastructure and built and horizontal datum that actually supports more greenery for housing, for mixed use, for farming, and even recreation and other uses. And yet, at the same time, you can actually create horizontal datums that allow services and certainly people mover systems to actually move entirely across the entire permeable lattice city. And at the same time, touching very likely on ground and actually not depending on automobiles at all. So it's a city without cars. I think the bottom word is missing. One thing that we need to think about is a paradigm shift for master planning and city planning. I think no longer can we think of a situation where we have infinite amount of land and we can keep stretching and build horizontally. And I think one of the things like in Guangzhou, they are actually uniting 9 cities to form a major hyper super city. And I think that's because, you know, they just keep taking up agricultural land and green land to create space for the city. But I think what is important for us to rethink planning is really to consider planning in multiple layers, in a three-dimensional integrated planning way. And in this, we were given a situation to design a master plan for a new town. And a new town for about 200 for a quarter million people, and this was actually done for a city in Southeast Asia in the tropics. And one of the things that we realized that if you can actually start designing at a large scale, at city planning scale, we shouldn't think of designing two dimensionally, thinking of land parcellation, and how you could actually cut out land and sell them and determine plot sizes. We think that you need to think holistically and drop all earlier notions of what a city would be. And one of the things that we realize that what we do need is to combine, is to create a very large datum so that we can actually harvest energy. The whole purpose of this exercise was really to create a zero energy new town. So in this situation, we decided that the idea of the New York city skyline, where you have the ups and downs, wasn't something that actually is very useful. It is very nice to look from the city from far, but I think the use of it, of all roofs, could be a big solar canopy where you have enough area to actually harvest enough solar energy to run the entire new city. So instead of choosing to have up and downs in the city skyline, we decided to invert the skyline to have the buildings undulating at the bottom and allow vegetation and allow the natural landscape to be maintained to weave across the entire city. So this was the section that we cut across the new town for 200,000 people. And it was also a situation where we were able to conceive it in such a way that we could actually segregate vehicles from pedestrians, and so that you do not have these two datums coming together. And so this is just a section across it. And also to be able to ring fence natural forest areas so that you can actually preserve the natural habitat. And yet at the top you can see that sort of hovers atop is a very large solar canopy that actually would be enough to generate energy for the entire city. So on this level, which we actually call the community terrain, it's actually free from vehicles. It's just only pedestrians, personal mobility machines like bicycles, kick scooters, electric scooters, and trams. No other vehicles would be seen where people would actually traverse. Those master plans for us translated into a real project which we are doing in Singapore, which is an integrated university master plan. And here we were given a very nice site, and that we could actually realize those ideas in the integrated master plan earlier. Currently, this is being processed in Singapore, and the aim is really to create a university that is actually zero energy. So the idea was really to use the forest as a metaphor, where you have in the roots and the underground layer purely for vehicles and for servicing cars and buses and mass rapid transit. on the natural ground is actually where we have the community park and the community terrain where people move freely without vehicles. And in the foliage area, we have all the accommodations and the academic areas. And at the roof, we actually have a tropical canopy that that actually provides enough energy for the city. So the idea translated into a schematic section would be something like this, where we do need to use exaggerated overhang to increase the canopy size so that we could actually have sufficient protection from rain, but at the same time being able to use that horizontal surface to create enough solar cells, so enough panel surface areas to actually create the zero energy university. And at the same time, the way you actually angle the solar panels, you can actually channel wind into areas below where you can actually have a nicer microclimate. And also under the layer of the solar panels, what we actually have done is that we have entire roof area that is actually used for urban farming. And there's actually enough urban farming to feed the entire population of the students in this campus. So the building was actually lifted off the ground, and using bioswales and retention ponds, we will be able to actually channel wind to actually blow across all the community park layer, so that it's actually a very nice a park for people to actually use and enjoy. So when you see the master plan at the plan level, you realize that the gray is really all the buildings that are actually designed in a traditional way. And the master plan of the university really is this entire area. Only the service corps and the columns actually touch the ground. Otherwise, it really is entirely a community park for this new town and also for the university. So in terms of the section, as we can see, we have managed to realize the ideas we had in the master plan, where it's actually an integrated manner in which we integrate many infrastructure and many different levels of users, mixed users, into an integrated master plan. One thing about high density, it doesn't necessarily mean that you can't have high amenity. We feel that you can actually infuse it enough so that you do not lose any quality of life and lose the livability in a high density. I think it actually can be done. In one of these proposals that we did in Singapore, it was one of creating a sort of a sporting recreational stadium with track and field as well as swimming pool, and that can be used actually for training for the Olympics at that level. And what we actually chose to do in this proposal was that instead of using the entire piece of land that was given to us, which was really the entire site, we chose to only build on half of it and to keep half of it really used as a park and to actually connect this park to an existing linear park that was adjacent to the site. We wanted to create a really nice usable park that has got ground level that we can actually have trees that can grow for over 100 years. And what we did was that we decided that it actually would be an intensified land use where we can actually do like a club sandwich approach. Infuse it with as many activities, but use the stadium as a tropical roof for all the activities under it. And you have all sorts of sporting events that you can actually have in this building. And you can actually have all the government agencies, shopping, retail, community spaces. And as a section, you also have a performing arts facility that is actually below the stadium, which will have multiple layers of sports.
事实上他有非常非常多想法，好比说，我用倒数，就是因为这样大家想起来比较容易，就是他刚提到就是生态的系统非常的重要，那在当中包括 Park Royal 的案子啦，然后新加坡就是那个看起来瀑布像一个洞底下，上面是在动物园的那个植物，那生物可以很自然的穿越，然后人往下压停车场啊，然后活动等等都往下压，好，然后其实在这里面他在谈到的一个很重要的 ecosystem 那包括之前跟早的Newton，那有蜜蜂在很高层有蜜蜂来叮小孩，然后侏儒有抱怨，事实上这样的一个ecosystem 这样的一个生态系统。 他在讲，我们在制造一个环境，创造一个环境的时候，不是只有为了人类哈。那事实上，在所有的个案当中，刚提了几个分享的案子里面，生态的移动，包括不同的物种，那也是他们非常重要的考量。那刚才提到就是有关于蓝跟绿哈，就是 green and blue 的这个比例哈。那在每一个的个案逐渐提升，从100%一直提到 Park Royal 的200%，甚至到最后的云华是260%哈。那事实上， 很重要就是他们希望能够带进更多的这样子的绿色的比例进来，而且在这个比例的过程当中，刚刚其中有个案你可以看到，不同的季节的变化，因为有了植物，然后有了这些植物在你的生活的周边，那一方面呢是柔化了整个建筑，一方面可以看到整个季节的不同的变化，那我们其实感受到季节的变化当中，啊，那其实花了很长的一个时间，我也做了很多笔记，是有关于generosity index，就是建筑这件事情其实不应该是在我们的基地里面自己量身定做而已，其实是要用一个更宽容的心，然后更大方的心，像我们台语同事同义词，大方，general，用更大方的心呢面对这个都市哦。那像他的举例来讲，像刚刚的那个第一个案子，就是他在新加坡的那个案子很有名，就是那个地铁 MRT 的那个地铁，就周围都是历史建筑的那个，那透过反影，那透过这样的一个方式呢，跟都市的纹理相连。可是同时，当 MRT 在地下30尺，就是说所有的捷运系统在地下的时候呢，那个整个的那块基地事实上是放给新加坡的居民是有一个非常漂亮的公园，可以让他们在那边移动。然后这样的水影是在地下室呢带进天光之外，那那个水影因为它的流动性也让整个建筑非常非常的柔化。其实我们在跟他的对谈当中有非常非常多次，他觉得我们硬邦邦的建筑是非常需要软化的，所以像这些的元素，包括我们刚刚提到的水，包括光线，然后包括绿这些事情，其实都是要让我们的建筑能够更柔化。然后呢，这个Newton也是一样，Newton自己这样长起来哈，就是刚刚那个垂直长起来，然后绿化非常非常成功。我们今天早上还在分享 Newton 这个，大家看到就是在台中的这些个案哈，其实即将要推这个案，那要长到20多公尺的垂直绿化，所以今天早上的媒体记者们都在问啊，这个垂直绿化的成熟度哦。那刚刚的 Newton 就在分享，Newton 当然也是得到非常重要的国际大奖。那这个案子里面，他就讲说 Newton 已经10年了，这个案子已经10年了。 可是10年的建筑物，我们都知道，10年建筑可能会旧。可是 Newton 看起来跟新的一样，因为覆盖它在它上面的绿色的植物，每一天它都会长出新的芽。所以它今天早上还讲，我觉得还蛮感人的。10年，他说看起来还像 Day One， 就像他第一天看到 Newton 完成的时候，还是那个绿色的生命，那个绿色的植栽，还是整个建筑物最重要的精神。 那么这个是一个很慷慨的概念说，说我不是把自己的房子盖好，我把这个房子盖好之后，其实我周边的邻居每一天都可以看到我这样子嫩绿的建筑，然后都会有非常愉悦的心情，所以这是跟邻居很好的一个分享。那么包括他们在刚刚还有一栋那个非常非常小的建筑，是他们的办公室旁边哦，寸土寸金，大家都知道，其实新加坡地其实非常非常贵，其实新加坡建筑整个比台湾还要贵哦。那随便的公寓，你看到其实千万好几千万一起跳。 那么在那样子寸土寸金的办公室，他们说服了业主把ground level，把地面层放出来，然后做成小小的公园。那这样小小的公园，其实让这个居民可以来这边，其实还有多一休闲的活动。但是最主要就是把这样的一个寸土寸金土地让给了都市之后，其实这个整个的价值也因而升级。那 Park Royal 是最明显的例子，因为 Park Royal这个案子，我们其实大家如果对新加坡文化的案子有熟悉的话，大家都知道这个案子，其实他刚刚在分享一点故事。 就当时 Park Royal 正对面的那个公园是一个中国商人捐出来的公园，那他们觉得这个中国商人捐给这个当时的工人的这个公园的这个心是非常的大方，非常的 general， 非常的慷慨。那么他希望这个他们在设计这个 Park Royal 的时候，也能够把这样子的想法，好，然后把他们尊敬的这个精神带到他们的设计里面。所以面对这样的公园的时候，其实 Park Royal 面向整个都市，其实用了非常非常多的绿色来面对整个都市。那一方面是层层的绿化的同时，然后包括里面的使用者。 穿廊，可以看得出来进到走道的空间里面，也不需要像我们一般去住五星级旅馆，是经过空调，经过这个自然灯光，而是在这种自然的氛围当中，你就从 landscape 里面走到你的房间，然后自然的风、自然的阳光、自然的植栽就在你旁边。他说也因为这样子，其实有非常多的顾客在使用之后，还特别写信感谢他们。那Paprio 呢，其实除了我们刚刚看到公园的面向之外，其实在他前面的论述当中也提到，不单单是绿色是给我们整个都市看得到之外，他 Paprio 还最成功的一个地方是，大家想想看，我们刚刚在讲寸土寸金的那个的新加坡的土地，他 Paprio 其中间他两大栋，一个是停车场，另外是居住的空间，然后再串在一起，他的那个穿廊在一楼的空间停留开放出来给整个市民非常非常方便的穿越。我在这边不免要回应一下，我们每次在都审跟在座的所有的公司呢、建筑师们一直在谈说，我们可以跟都市土地的连结。你看在这么寸土寸金、这么贵的土地，其实就在讲就是这件事情。因为你的串联，你给了邻居方便，因为你的大方，其实你的建筑整个就是非常非常有价值。非常非常的价值哦。那 Paprio 这个其实当那个可以当有好几个画面，非常非常容易的穿越，然后甚至走在人行道，走在靠近这个Paprio 这个建筑的旁边，其实都是非常舒服的尺度，内跟外的互动也是非常非常好。这是他们在营造整个，虽然是一个五星级的饭店，事实上这个五星级的饭店是为当地的这个环境来打造，完全不是说哦为了我五星级的客户，或者是我为了盈利的目的，完全不是这样的一个想法哦。所以generosity 就是这慷慨跟大方的观念，在整个都市的设计的尺度当中非常非常的重要。好，那我其实就倒着，我觉得我做的笔记有点乱哎，还是 Pearl， I'm so sorry. Do you want to add something to this? Maybe you can add the front part.
大家好，我是 Woha Pro。其实最后那段，我们是从我们过去20年的工作经验，是有机会跟有那个适合的机会来实验这些设计的想法。那在我们未来的10年，我们是想更加投入在就是刚才我们Mansam 有说是否我们可以有一个重新定义城市建筑的成功指数的 index， how can we score it， you know， is that a new index？ 所以这个成功指数可能可以从几个方面来看，这些方面其实在我们过去所完成的工程里面，我们都可以看到它成功的地方。第一就是绿色空间，怎么增加绿色空间，那不单只是要绿化一个建筑，除了绿化之外，我们更在意就是建筑对周遭的邻里社区有什么影响，有什么贡献。所以刚才你会看到我们在考量比如说community plot ratio， 这个邻里的那个容积率，这是很新的一个概念那除了绿色的容积率，我们可以考虑也有一个公共设施的容积率吗？那还有就是建筑对生态系统的影响是不是也是值得我们考量的地方那回到先前，就是其实这整个讲座的题目其实是说怎么放大这建筑的用途，因为在现在新的亚洲城市，因为从大概从青春期到现在可能逐渐要成熟的城市，我们更加应该注意到怎么利用建筑，怎么放大建筑的用途来就是把那个城市规划里面重叠可能有时很矛盾的用途的地方融入在这个建筑里面，所以 macro architecture micro urbanism 这就是我们想要就是突破，想一直在寻求有新的设计来解决这些在城市里面我们需要解决的重复的这些用途啦功能。那比如说高密度的建筑是否就是说我们会失去我们需要的公共设施不然其实我们认为高密度跟高公共设施是可以并存的。还有就是另外一个设计里面是重复的地面，是否在建筑里面我们可以再重复地面在空中有街道，在空中有地面的花园有地面的园林和走廊大概是这些。
除了这个之外，其实我觉得还蛮有一个蛮重要的议题，我再帮忙补充一样，就是他刚刚提到 Sky Garden、Sky Streets， 然后 Sky Village， 就在他的很多的个案里面呢，那个刚提到的那个multiple ground levels， 就是我们现在一般很习惯在使用地面层。那台湾好像看起来那个一楼以上，尤其台中市这样的城市，一楼以上就魔咒，就很难去被使用。那其他就刚在提的这议题是当中，他们也有非常多成功的干，像刚的新加坡学院，它很多都是五楼、九楼开始是很重要的 ground level 的平面层。那其实他刚有一个提案，应该是在深圳的办公大楼，非常精彩哦。Is that the competition or that's the one? So you want it or? Okay, great. Okay, so we're gonna see that. 那个深圳那个办公大楼非常精彩，因为你刚刚大家有注意看，它其实是一个非常有趣的概念的前瞻性。当他因为他提到，他说那个办公大楼的表情非常丰富，跟我们现在看到台湾我们传统的办公大楼表情是很接近，也许每一个面会有一点变化，但那个表情非常丰富。大家知道吗？就刚那个策略里面，其实他是把小企业跟大企业是放在一起的，它里面有很多是小的很精致，像SOHO族的办公室，然后也有大企业。I think OK。然后小的建设，你刚刚看会有很多小的 cluster， 就是簇群这样的概念在那边，然后但是也有很大的企业在里面，然后在里面呢形成一个一个簇群当中，不同的是我们刚刚讲不同的地面层 ，multiple 的 ground level， 把那个地面层不是只有在这边，很多的楼层开始产生。那包括其实它是非常自给自足的一个办公大楼，因为它希望里面其实还有其他的相关设施，像 daycare。你在里面上班的人，大家其实现在做的都是双薪家族哦，就是爸爸妈妈都上班，小孩子往哪丢？所以其实在那个大楼里面还包括所有的可以关怀到的设施，甚至包括很轻而易举能够采购的一些便利的商店啊，甚至用餐等等，其实都在那个大楼里面。那很重要就是那个 multiple 的那个 ground level， 就是那个地面层，因为你的地面层可以很丰富的被垂直提高，那这个地面层在他们的策略里面就是用了非常非常多的绿色空间进去，也就是说那个绿色事情一直往上带，所以 Sky Garden， 然后 Sky Street 街道，空中的街道，那最后形成所谓的空中的 Village。 那他一直在提到Sky Village 这个概念，其实 Sky Village 对他来讲制造这个垂直的这个聚落的感觉，事实上就是在制造所谓垂直的绿色的社群。然后他其实刚刚也提到，因为是 community， 其实就是 home， 在这个社群当中，你来到这边，也许你们彼此不认识，可是你常来到这边，就像你的家一样。那在这个 community 里面，在这个 village 里面，其实你就熟悉的时候，它成为你的，就像你的家庭一样。因此，其实人跟人之间的距离呢，就变成比较 close， 比较能够亲近在一起。所以在他们的设计里面当中，其实最终目的当然还是为人的使用来做设计。然后这当中有非常非常多的设计的手法，我们刚刚也都提过。其实当中很重要，就是其实整个文化的设计元素是非常非常的自然。你可以看得出来，就说第一个，它在数次刚刚的个案提到，那个整个的 ventilation， 就是那个空调系统用自然的通风啊。甚至刚才讲，新加坡有个个案，他们设计的时候太超前了，那时候新加坡政府还不能理解。到后来才理解到，其实他们的很多的个案，这种自然的，我们所谓被动式的设计的概念，其实他们一直对他们来说是非常非常重要。所以其实他们的案子不要认为是为贵族量身打造。刚刚在看很多的 social housing， 就是2000户的那个提案，也是 multiple， 就是 multiple green ground level 往上提，然后绿色一样，不管你今天是 社会住宅、公共住宅，或者是今天是豪宅，像 Newton 这样的住宅，像 Max 曼谷这样的住宅，甚至像我们台湾的这个云华的住宅，其实都是一样，设计的元素都是这样子。最终的目的，这个建筑最终的目的是为了营造美好的环境，而这个环境最终打造的目的是为了使用者。然后这当中用了非常非常多的不同的策略在这个空间当中。我想要补充一下，就是最后一个云华的案子，其实就即将发生在我们台中的案子。其实我刚刚一开幕其实讲到这个案子，很希望它有一些机会成为台中的指标。那其实这个案子应该算是今天首次吧，第一次正式曝光哈。那我们算是当委员是看过这个案子，这个案子应该算是首次曝光，所以这个案子我觉得有一些事情可以稍微再提醒一下。刚刚提到的 A、B 栋就是有两栋，一个是面对公益跟大墩，另外一栋就是在比较巷弄靠近家乐福十二街的巷弄的空间。其实两栋的都市策略是不同的。那 A 栋呢，我们称之为面对主要道路，就是公益路。当时新加坡团队来到台中市看到公益路的时候，觉得非常的惊讶，因为大家知道那个在新加坡在我们台湾的公益路是非常的著名，所以对于我们一个美食的文化的时候呢，我当时说服他们，如果我们在这边能够打造一个地标建筑，不单单是只有吃，建筑本身成为一种新的地标文化进来，成为新的艺术品进来。所以呢，这个公益路跟大墩路事实上退缩是10.8米，各10.8米。所以他们当时的设计策略就是希望它退缩这么多，希望在主要的都市的这个面向当中，能够制造垂直的 linear park。垂直的带状的空间的感觉，绿色带状的空间，延续整个公益路，甚至到大墩路这样的一个转角。所以，当我们的法定是退缩4米，而我们退缩了10.8米的时候，我们就有6.多米的空间，可以让我们的 A 栋其实有一个一个伸出来的阳台。那是因为我们在台湾的法规，他们也知道我们的法规是这样，之后他们很敏感的就反映出 A 栋的建筑是有一栋一栋伸出来的植栽。阳台就像是一个一个的橱窗，让绿色的植物像一个一个的橱窗，非常活泼的舞者在整个大楼这样垂直跳跃。那 B 栋呢，因为只有退缩4米5米，所以它能够伸出来的空间就没有了，因此 B 栋呢就看起来像是穿上了绿色的衣服，这是在 AB 栋的一个差异哦。那当然他刚刚提到非常重要一个观念，我现在提到就是我们在沟通过程中我觉得很惊艳的地方是，第一个，他们对台湾的法规的敏感度反映出来的设计的造型是非常非常有表情，而且完全是法规底下长出来的结果。这个让我们通常建筑师会抱怨法规给我们的限制，我们没有可以展现的地方，那非常有趣，是这样的结果出来产生 AB 不同表情。另外一个非常有趣我也想分享，就是我们刚刚有注意到他们的 Sky Garden 在我们的大墩公益这边，不像刚刚在其他国家好像一跳跳10层，我们这边一跳跳5层，好5、6层、5层或6层，然后是跳层的，东西南北向都有 Sky Garden。 可是为什么跳5、6层呢？因为他看到了5期的发展跟7期是不一样，早期的密度的尺度是比较低的，所以他们的空中跳层是跳5、6层跳一次，不是像我们如果在7期我们看到很多尺度都高的，可能那个策略可能会完全不一样。那5、6层他认为这是反映5期的都市早期的一个都市的问题，所以他 Sky Garden 跳大概是5、6层跳层一次。好，那当然刚刚也提到就是所谓的这个活动的绿带，然后还有就是我们在这当中还有一个就是最困难的地方是，我们其实因为有这么多的植栽，经常也在讨论，媒体记者都在问这个问题哦。那问就说在新加坡的这些植栽可以活，那在台湾能不能活？好，那这些能够活起来的植栽，台湾的接受度怎么样？所以其实我们花了好长好长的时间，然后接下来在盖的过程的3年，以及盖好之后的5年，我们在场张立新老师应该在场，我真的要非常谢谢他，也要给他非常大的掌声哦，因为张立新老师在我们建筑系扮演非常重要的角色。以前建筑系都没有景观的老师，我们有了张老师之后，我们的建筑系就非常绿啊。然后我们的建筑系就学会怎么样跟绿色植物一起共生，没有它，建筑就太硬。所以透过张老师的协助，东西南北向不同的表情、不同的植栽，我们接下来3年，我们就要在不同的风向、不同的方位角、不同的高度开始做施种。新加坡可以成功，我们要保证它在台湾也能够成功。那我们希望这个成功的典范能够移转在我们整个台中市，甚至在台湾，我们可以让这个垂直绿化是能够成功的。然后最后一点，我觉得最重要的一个观念是，他们的绿化希望是容易被养护的，是你可以照顾得到的，然后不是这种高养护的绿色植栽。所以我想细节的部分如果各位还有兴趣的话，也许在会后好的盘玉如果愿意开始慢慢公开分享一些观念，那我想 generous generous aspects, right? 大方的观念的底下呢，我们其实开始哦，希望能够透过这个案子，让我们台中市的建筑其实可以越来越美，然后越来越绿。好，那么在一开始其实提到了很多未来的都市的真的那个绿体绿化的想象，这我就不多说。其实刚开始的好一大段的幻灯片在想，也许更以后的我们的城市，如果我们现在不想什么，就来不及了。所以未来的立体城市，甚至新加坡当这样的一个密度到人口膨胀到好几倍的时候，这些立体城市的一些想法，那我今天就不多说。那在他们的书里面，其实他们有分享到一些立体城市的一些观念。好，那接下来的时间，我想我们应该开放给现场的听众朋友，也许大家会有很多的想法，会有很多的问题，那想要透过这样的一个机会来提问。好，那我们是不是现在就开始我们的 Q&A？哦，是，我们的那个台中市建筑师工会的理事长，郑理事长要提问。哦，郑理事长一定要到这边来
的。我是被污染过的建筑师啊，所以我们每次在谈，我们两个都叽叽呱呱在讲，都是误事的，其实都跟盘玉有关啊。那不过我想，因为无法到至少当然也要看他去过很多的国家，那我们不太可能。每一次都期待有盘玉这种非常 generosity 的开发商啊。等一下，也许可以问一下盘玉，他到底在里面有没有做太多的努力 ，or 我们叫做牺牲啊？但是我们一直很期待说，也许我们有。我们刚才在谈说，我们法规才二十几个字限制了我们所有的阳台啊，不两米，还有八分之一，没几个字嘛，把我们的所有的。我们的有可能性都限制住，但是我想没有关系。今天吴好在这边，我想我们比较希望得到的是，在走过这么多的国家，尤其是他也到过台湾，那台湾的法规对他一定有一些限制。那台湾的法规，尤其是这种 Sky Garden， 然后multiple ground level， Sky Bridge。Sky Street， 这些在我们 Building Code 里面，在不同的国家 ，compare with Taiwan's Building Code，is there any difference for encourage or discourage？ For us， we know the Building Code in Taiwan is discourage. You do the multiple ground level or the Sky Street. We know there is no encourage.For you, for architect or developer to do this. However, in Singapore or in Thailand, is there any difference for the building code to treat with your idea or your design concept? Thank you.
I think Singapore situation is slightly different.Singapore recognizes, actually when we did Newton Suites, more than almost 10 years ago, there were no, the government did not support it. It was through our initiative that we decided that we wanted to do Sky Gardens. There was no incentives. And also at the same time, the 100 meters Green Wall 2 was our own initiative.It was a discussion we had with the developer. The developer was an architect I mentioned before as well. We said that we are actually providing very small homes because this was the homes were getting smaller each day in Singapore because of the expensive land prices. So he wanted to do smaller apartments, and we felt that maybe we need to think of a way to create.Open spaces for them. So that's one thing that in the end, the government recognizes that the Sky Garden created a very interesting image for Singapore. The government henceforth, after seeing Newton Suites created a rule that you must have 100% replacement in the city area. And just really recently, last year, they extended this almost throughout Singapore. So the intention preceded the regulations, but now the regulations facilitate VGFA. But the point, the difference is that a Singapore land cost is very expensive. If you think of a sale price, if the apartment costs $1 million, 80% is the land cost, 200% is the construction cost. I think here it's the other way around at least, I think. Maybe. It's quite different. So half. So the construction cost is, the land cost is a little less. So I think the only thing to do is to, the developers need to see whether there's actually value in the sky gardens. So you can actually have to see whether you're willing to sacrifice some of the areas for the sky gardens. Having said that, we have been quite successful in other countries as well, like in India. We have been able to convince the owners, because India has got very little public spaces and very little gardens. So they see that as a value add to the design. So they're willing to say, yes, I'm willing to sacrifice 10% of our area and turn into sky gardens. So it's a conversation that we have with the developer, depending on the situation in each city, how it's actually the city, the regulation is actually works. As far as technical details here, it's Singapore has its very peculiar rules as well, and Pan Chong also has got its very peculiar rules as well. Mm,
我觉得新加坡还是我们经常都会尽力去争取做空中花园，不单是只是法规方面，而且还是就是地产商的邻里方面，他们要考量呀，因为寸土如金，所以地产的价格是非常高的，所以对这方面的衡量还是，我觉得我们还是要下很大的功夫去说服，政府或地产商。那政府法规其实，自从 Newton Suites 之后，他们可以看得出。绿化对整个建筑的那个外观，有提升。对新加坡作为一个城市，花园城市来说，有很大的就是有增加它的价值，跟就是整个国家的那个形象来说，他们觉得是有价值的。所以在政府方面，可能法规他们有一些鼓励性的措施，比如说市区的地段。如果你要发展整个地，土地的话，你要再回归100%，绿色或者是植栽啊、或花园，那在市区之外，其实并不一定是100%，有些地区是40%或者60%，也要看什么地区，所以在法规上其实还是真的要去争取的，应该是跟台湾有点关系。就是台湾应该 也是有这样的法规的限制，有时当然也要看，地产商他们对于这个，比如说在印度的地产商，他们觉得有空中花园其实是增加他们售卖时候的价值，因为在比如说孟买这些地方是非常非常缺少，绿公园或者是公共的花园，所以当他们买地产的时候，他们会把这个加入他们考虑的因素。所以地产商的想法会很不一样，在不同国家。那刚才其实空中花园，其实我们觉得是，有其他功能，不仅仅是软化整个硬邦邦的建筑。其实如果在比如说我们做的那公共主屋的那个空中花园，其实住在那边的居民，他们不需要一直就搭电梯。从40楼的住家到地面的那个公园，其实他们只需要走3层或者是上4层，他们就已经可以直接走到一个空中花园。比如说爸爸妈妈不需要真的可以让他们孩子下去这空中花园玩耍，他们还是可以就是间接可以看到他们有一定的安全感，而且在使用电梯或者是能源方面，我们觉得还是可以节省啊，不需要一直就是用电梯上下，一个很高楼、很高的主屋。
我们是误解了吗？他们都 skydiver 没有 bonus 哎。
But they don't count as flying.
Ah, they don't count it. That's bonus.
That's bonus.
That's bonus. 他们不计算，我们计算。
Still construction cost.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Of course, yeah. 他们不算，他不计算到那个面积。我们台湾计算，好，我们还是可以有。你看他们说那个，自从 Newton 之后，改变新加坡城市的印象，好像在座我们大家都可以一起努力哦，好像可以努力跟政府来谈看哦。我们到我们的台，至少台中市吧，哈、哦，我们今天台中市代表就没来啊，就这么忙啊，都邀请啦、啊，都不来啊。我们应该再开启另外一个窗口，对不对？啊、哦，
培养一个建筑
署长。副署长有啊，是学建筑的啊，我的同学啊。对啊，但是也要开启一个窗口啊。我但是不会听我的话，好，所以意思是说，你看我们今天的演讲有一个，如果有个共识，也许我们可以努力看看。啊、哦，那透过 Newton 哦，第一个这样的案子影响新加坡，他认为这样的一个城市啊、哦、的美丽，其实是有机会透过这样的一个政策面来达到。也许我们可以努力一下，让我们的建筑更有机会。好，来，我们看到第二个问题，是，来，我们施学长。
Can I ask a quick question in Mandarin? It's okay? 我很好奇、哦、就是说、今天、给了我们很多很好的观念、哦、但是如果说我好、遇到的一个情况、就是说、可能是一个很寒冷的地区，然后有多、地震或是有台风，或是说它的土地价格很便宜，那在我好遇到这种、业主、这种情况的话，会是怎么样的一个处理情况？谢谢。
We practice in many cities. We are doing a project in Japan now, and Japan is certainly an earthquake area. But you have to understand the structure of earthquake buildings. In a very similar way, actually, Taichung.It's based on the very similar standards. The gridded structure is actually almost impossible to break away. So, but there is still potential in it. And we have been able to find interest within the constraints of this city. I think we are having different conditions every city that we go to.They're all, for us, starting from scratch and seeing how we can actually apply our solutions to it. But there's no, nothing that actually prevents it from happening. If you find the solutions, you can actually do it. In fact, we had the same problem with our project in Taipei. And I think they were concerned about the true ventilation.But instead, we choose not to have true ventilation. We do have high-rise greenery, but it's actually not true ventilation. It's actually they can close off. So the wind actually doesn't go inside the spaces. We actually did a wind tunnel test. You can actually see how wind behaves in the building. So it's not through trial and error. It's actually through scientific methods that we actually work out the solution for each building.
不同国家因为他们有不同的地势或者是不同的天气啊。但是我觉得比如说日本，我们现在有一个工程在日本或者是中国或者是印度，其实他们也想就是有这个外面的空间跟里面的空间这样子的一个延续，他们也想有这样子的空间，所以我觉得是我们觉得是比较如果我们可以把我们的设计的方案在不同的国家落实在他们自己，当然有自己的规范，但是其实我觉得大家的目标都是差不多一致的，其实是想争取说室外室内的空间结合起来，对吧？
好，其实他们的设计哦非常重要，到不同的地方性有不同的反应。那事实上他们还是透过一些科学的方法，刚刚讲风洞的测试啊，阳光什么这些 我其实要分享故事，他可能忘了，三年前他来演讲，我忘记他是在哪个，他 think it's in Europe， 大概在欧洲，就是他提过一个案子，但我忘记是哪一个案，他说台风来了，所有的绿色植物全部死光了，可是隔一年的春天，所有的绿芽又全部长出来，他说这就是自然的力量，那也就是为什么一直强调很低氧，所以气候的严苛其实每一个地方都会有，但是自然能够在那个地方生存下来的那个生存的力量，在每一个地方都不得忽视。好，我们看到最后一个问题，糟了，怎么办？竞争者来剪刀石头布，怎么办呢？啊 ，Which one goes first? I think okay, the second one. Sorry， 然后也许事后再问来，不好意思，中间这一位，黄德生老师吗？你干嘛跟我们客人抢题目啊？啊，真的吗？你问好了，你问好了，你先举手先赢。It's one of our professor.
Actually, I have two questions, but very short. The first question is I want to ask about the following, like once the building or each project is finished, how did they manage those vegetations? Because like the cost for the maintenance is very important, actually. And the project compared to the condominium and also the office building, I guess that the managed way approach will be very different.Because as what I understand, the condominium, each unit, once they sold to the client, actually the developer has nothing to do with that. So how do you maintain that? Because each unit, the owner is very different. And also, what's the role for the firm after the project completed? Because I guess you still need to follow up with like, how the growth of vegetation. Well, this is the first question. I will ask the second question very quickly. For the social, perspective that you mentioned about, but I would like to ask you your opinions. What's the similarity and the differences between the traditional pub space and also the space of what you call like the sky garden, sky street? Because I guess you're trying to replicate the original settlement of this primary tie between peoples, but I'm not sure whether how this assessed and whether the people, the type of people they use or activity they use, could you.I guess it's very different from the streets, very diversity, because I guess each condominium is like a gated community, so the users are very similar. I guess the background, especially based on the SES, like the social backgrounds. Thank you.
第一个问题是有关于管理，有关于绿色的这些怎么回复。那第二个问题就是有关于在 social 上面，传统的公园跟我们现在讲的抬起来的这些高层的这些，我们刚刚讲的 sky garden 它有什么不同？大概这样。
I give you two scenarios in Singapore where we implemented greenery extensively, but both cases in all ourdesigns, the maintenance is one of the things that we need to consider in the planning. We don't need to use gondolas to maintain the plants. We actually physically walk to the planter and maintain it. That's the first rule for us. It's easy maintenance, no different from if you are standing on the ground. So that's one. Okay. The other thing is that it's not true that you don't need maintenance, you do need maintenance. But you need people who actually love greenery.We have Newton Suites that's 10 years already, and it's still looking very good. We don't have to worry about it. Somehow, the people who live there actually likes the greenery, and also they realized that the building was different, and that it could actually achieve better rentals for the building than compared to the others around it. So they accepted that it would cost to maintain it, and they actually have a maintenance corporation that actually,that's a very good job at it. So that's one scenario. In SOTA, this is a government school, they award the maintenance contract to the lowest price tender. And this is a bit of a headache for us. Every 6 months, I have to go and talk to the contractor and make sure that he doesn't cut corners. So that's the problem with, it's easy to maintain still because it's on horizontal ground level.But because it was the lowest price maintenance contract, the contractor was trying to cut corners. So when the landscaping didn't look like it's actually doing as well, I would call the principal up and say, I'm going to come and inspect it with the landscape contractors and find out what's wrong with it. So I've been doing that with the last 5-6 years for the school. Maybe once 6 months I would visit it and to check on it. And that's quite nice because it's a public school and something that we enjoy doing that as well. Even for like not just greenery, but our lens, our reflection pool in the MRT station. In the past in Europe, people built fountains, you know, the Trevi fountains, they have all this, they are wonderful, and this is what you go to Europe to see. But in modern day, we don't do that anymore. It is very sad. So when we did this, after this, we finished the building, we wrote into our office systems to remind the authority, land transport authority, to check and maintain the systems every 2 years. So we always remind the client, please do something about it. So, and I think if we are committed enough to our ideas, we follow through with it. Now, your second question was whether or not replicating some of those ideas about social spaces, gathering spaces in buildings. I think it is not 100% basically, but I think it's through observation to see what is wrong with what we are doing and how we can correct them and how we can find ways to encourage them. Okay? And I think one of the things that we realized with Park Royal Pickering, it tickles people's everyday life. You find people who stop at the junctions and take photographs. It is very, very rare, okay? And this little gardens that we created on the office buildings, we have people in motorbikes, the courier boys, you know, who deliver food, who deliver magazines. They drive here, they gather there, and they have lunch. You know? And I think if you create a nice environment that's accessible, yes. But if you create sky gardens that are a destination and not part of the way, they will not work. That's our observation.
在社区里面的公众花园，如果要成功的话，其实它必须是在设计上你需要很注意，就是它不应该是放在一个角落的花园，它应该是居民或居民经常出入的那个地方，那他们才会充分利用到，或者是觉得他们真的是拥有，这是他们拥有的一个公共设施，他会去照顾，他会去用它，所以在设计上其实必须要就是注意。 并不是说你创造了一个空中花园，它就会对社区的凝聚力有好处，对啊。那关于植栽的方面，其实，在我们那个公共组屋的工程，我们跟其实他们有一个市政会，政府的市政会是在管理这些公共组屋的。那我们在设计的。 过程当中也跟他们有很多很多的讨论，就是种植的植栽的那个树种，这些都有经过很长时间的一个讨论，对这个维护方面以后的考量，我们在刚开始已经都会有一个共识才去进行，对啊，所以其实他们对维护来说是完全有心理准备的。
One more answer to your question. When we create the aesthetic that incorporates greenery with it, we are not saying that the greenery must remain 100% beautiful and lush. I think we call it it's a robust aesthetic. If your landscaping don't grow well, the building must still look very good. Okay. So I think that was our understanding also with our project in Paichou. That if someone do not maintain it, the facade will look beautiful. It's complementary whether or not the material used and the landscaping can grow and thrive in it. So we do not want to leave it to chance and depend. I mean, I think people say that you cover your building with landscaping if you've got bad architect, you know. But in this case, the building must be a beautiful building without plants as well. So it will still be good.
最后其实他在补充的是建筑本身视觉上就是美的，即便植物长不好也是美，但是植物如果长不好表示那栋建筑的维护就不好，他现在在讲给潘玉婷，然后讲给我们大家听，因为我们大家都觉得植物很容易其实很难，那我其实要补充一点，他刚刚讲非常非常重要，就是他们的植物，你看到那些漂亮的植物都是人可以很轻而易举走到维护的方式，绝对不是很难养护的方式，他希望那个植栽。就是你很容易可以去处理的方式，那大概就是你可以知道。所以他们的平面图，接下来如果大家有入他们的书，你们可以调出来看。他所有的垂直绿化，希望都是人可以很容易去 maintain 的。那刚刚的问题就是那个公园，传统的我们社交的这种公园，跟我们在这种空中的公园有什么不同？我觉得刚刚的回答，我想我不用比较简短的方式。就对沃哈而言，绿色的 green garden 不是为了目的，为了要公园而要公园，它其实是一个在我们生活中每一天的生活当中一个更有序的方式。那希望这样的一个有序的方式，确实是可以促进我们在里面生活的居民，以及我们生态，我们人类生活的生态的环境跟系统能够更美好。好，那我们今天的体验讲可能就必须到这里画下句点，是不是？我们再一个人掌声，谢谢今天的团队。我们接下来就是各位听众，我想我们可以自行离开哈。我一般不会。